And now on to part two of September 13th, 2020, worship service. The rest of the story, now that things have worked for downloading the rest of the story, if you'd like to hear the scripture reading read again, then I would invite you to do so. And the message is, are you a scorekeeper? And so as you're listening to the scripture being read, I'd like to invite you to just think about how you play sports or maybe cards, or perhaps it's who cuts the lawn more or who unloads the dishwasher more or less than the other. How many loads of laundry and how many loads of laundry can you get done in one day? Just think of all those things that we like to keep score of. And sometimes we don't even realize it. Sometimes it's a competition with ourselves just to see if we can beat the clock and do something. Sometimes it's a matter of whether we can have a scorekeeper for a baseball game. And I can vividly remember as a child sitting at the baseball park in Appen and watching my brothers play baseball. And sometimes I would get the opportunity to keep score. And what was interesting is one of the key factors about being a scorekeeper, regardless of what game you are playing or how you're going about it, you might even be playing pool. You might be curling, playing hockey, watching basketball, baseball, whatever the case may be. And you have to pay attention. If you are not paying attention as a scorekeeper, you will quickly lose your job. And why? Because you don't want to get it wrong. 9 times out of 10, there's a winner and a loser. Or at least you know who ties in the end. So take these next few moments, and if you'd like to listen to the scripture being read again and the quote from Mr. Rogers, or you can skip ahead in about 5 minutes and continue from there. I'll see you in just a moment. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Matthew chapter 18, verses 21 to 35. Let us listen to the word of God. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how long should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold. Together he and his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of the slave released him and forgave him his debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. And seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw that what had happened, they were greatly distressed. And they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then his Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my Heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from the heart. Thanks be to God for his holy and everlasting word. Amen. The title of the message this week is, Are You a Scorekeeper? And Mr. Rogers said this, Forgiveness is a strange thing. It can sometimes be easier to forgive our enemies than our friends. It can be hardest of all to forgive people we love. Like all of life's important coping skills, the ability to forgive and the capacity to let go of resentments most likely takes root very early in our lives. Barbara Brown Taylor, she wrote a sermon and it was entitled Arthritis of the Spirit, which was resentment. And she started it by saying, in case you have not noticed, Christianity is a religion in which the sinners have all the advantages. They can step on your feet 50 times and you are supposed to keep smiling. They can talk bad about you every time you leave the room, and it is your job to excuse them with no thought of getting even. The burden is on you because you have been forgiven yourself, and God expects you to do unto others as God has done unto you. Now, this isn't a bad motivation for learning how to forgive. If God is willing to stay with me in spite of my meanness, she continues, my weakness, my stubborn self-righteousness, then who am I to hold those things against someone else? Better I should confess my own sins than keep track of yours. Only it's hard to stay focused on my shortcomings. I would so much rather stay focused on yours, especially when they are hurtful to me.
Over the past few years, I've been on this journey of writing songs inspired by the real life stories that people sent to me. This one story in particular has had a profound impact on me. It hit me kind of hard. It's about a woman who did the impossible, and it made me ask myself if I could do the same. Renee had four kids. Two of her daughters were twins. Megan was coming home from the beach one night with her best friend when their car was struck by a drunk driver named Eric, a 24-year-old kid. Megan lost her life. Eric killed both girls that were in the car. Renee lost her daughter in an instant. Next thing she knows, she finds herself in a courtroom watching this young man, this 24-year-old man, get sentenced to 22 years in prison. Renee wrote to me and said, I now have a mission that I never would have chosen. What she meant by that is that in the years that follow, she began to travel around to schools and churches and different functions, and she would speak about the dangers of drunk driving. But as the years progressed, she felt like something was missing from her presentations. And that's when God put it on her heart that she had not forgiven this man who took the life of her daughter. And so she reached out and did the impossible. She reached out to Eric in prison and said, I forgive you. The ripple effects of that act of forgiveness are still being felt today. That young man's life was absolutely changed because this woman forgave him. He said, I can't even forgive myself, and she forgave me. Eric said he found his eternal salvation as a result of this act. One by one, all of Renee's family members followed her lead, and they reached out and expressed forgiveness to Eric. So much so that now they describe Eric as part of their family, like a son to Renee. The story doesn't stop there, though. Renee went to the courts along with her family, and she was able to have Eric's sentence cut in half from 22 years to 11 years. This blew me away. The reason she did it is so that Eric could have a second chance at life and so that he could join her in their presentations. She told me that now she shares not only about the dangers of drunk driving, but also about the power of forgiveness.
anything on your mind today? It always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they caused is just too real. Takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. It flies in the face of all your pride, moves away the mad inside. It's always anger's own worst enemy. Even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying set it free. Forgiveness. Even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you. Forgiveness.
The hardest part about forgiveness is often forgiving ourselves when we fall short. Making changes is hard and it's nearly impossible. It actually is impossible without God's grace. But we can be successful when we learn to forgive ourselves as well. Perhaps you've grown up in a Christian home with the Christian faith. And if so, you've probably heard countless sermons about forgiveness and sang countless hymns and songs about the subject of forgiveness. It's talked about a lot, but there are many people still hanging on to grudges and hurts from their past. Unfortunately, many of us like to keep score because the game can't go on without us. Unfortunately, as Matthew West's song says, the person it sets free is us. When we forgive, we're set free because of what Jesus did for us. Christ died on the cross, not because he needed forgiveness, but he knew we needed forgiveness. He wanted to give us hope for a future so that no one would perish. God's forgiveness is amazing, and we all need a reminder of how powerful it is. I'd like to share this story with you about a woman named Shannon Etheridge. Shannon was just 16 years old, and an act of forgiveness and love has changed her life forever. Driving to her high school one morning, Shannon struck and ran over Marjorie Jarstfar, who was riding her bicycle along a country road. Marjorie died, and Shannon was found completely at fault by the authorities. Consumed by intense guilt, she contemplated suicide. Several times she battled this, but she never took her life because of the healing response that she received from one man, Gary Jarstfar. Gary, Marjorie's husband, forgave the 16-year-old and asked the attorney to drop all charges against her. This saved her from an almost certain guilty verdict. And instead, he simply asked Shannon to continue in the godly footsteps that his wife had taken. "You can't let this ruin your life," Gary told her more than 20 years ago. "God wants to strengthen you. In fact, I am passing Marjorie's legacy on to you." Gary's act of forgiveness showed Shannon the amazing restorative love of God. That act became the foundation of her work, seeking to help people overcome guilt-ridden, wounded lives. Sometimes our greatest misery can become the foundation of our greatest ministry. Like I said, God's forgiveness is amazing, and we all need a reminder of how powerful it is. Consider what God has done for you in your life. How many times that you have had a second chance. Forgiveness doesn't excuse another's behavior. Forgiveness prevents their behavior from destroying you and I. Jesus' forgiveness is even more amazing than Renee's. He forgave us so that we might live sinless and free with Him. Forgiveness means being selfless, being a prisoner set free, doing the impossible, spared from anger, not holding someone's wrongdoing against them. And Jesus told us how to forgive. In the Gospels, Jesus gave us many instructions on how and who to forgive. And Jesus wants this for us. His instructions are love your enemies, lend without expecting to be repaid, pray for those who hurt you, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, be compassionate as our Father is compassionate to us, forgive others and you will be forgiven. That's what Jesus' forgiveness is all about. When forgiveness is shown, kindness, solutions to problems, reconciliation in families and the coming together of friends, relief, peace, understanding, happiness, light hearts, even joking comments become what bond us back together in the love of Jesus. The song Forgiveness has so many great lyrics because of this story. It always goes to those who don't deserve. That's forgiveness. That is forgiveness. Consider what God has done in your life for you, and how many times you have received a second chance. I know that I have received more than I could ever imagine or count. 7 times 70, more than 77, and yet daily I go back to the cross seeking forgiveness once again. That is the power of the cross of Christ. Who do you need to ask forgiveness of today? And who could you offer forgiveness to and set that person free so that they might experience the love and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the salvation that He wants for each one of us? Forgiveness, show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. Forgiveness. Thanks be to God. Amen.